Welcome to the online ministry of Pacific Beach United Methodist Church, located in beautiful San Diego, California. Pacific Beach UMC is a member of the Reconciling Ministries Network and welcomes persons of all ages and backgrounds for worship, study, and service opportunities. More information can be found on our website at pbumc.org. May you be enriched by the hearing of these words, and may you receive and enjoy God's blessing.
Welcome and good morning and happy new year. We made it to 2021. We gather together for worship on this Sunday, which is called Epiphany Sunday, and we are mindful of the ways that God appears in our midst. I welcome you to this time of worship. I'm thankful for each one who is gathered as a part of this fellowship and community. I invite you, if you haven't already done so, to sign in using our friendship pad. You can put your name and contact information and a prayer request and hit send. This is Communion Sunday, so I also invite you to gather your communion elements to use at home. We will celebrate the sacrament together at the latter part of the service. We will take a special communion offering. This is our Human Relations Sunday in the life of the United Methodist Church. That offering focuses on communities at risk and providing support around social justice issues with special care for youth at risk. We open our hearts and our spirits for all that is new in this year, knowing that God seeks us as we open our spirits and seek God. Let us gather together for worship as Laura and Ron lead us in a time of music.
The Magi had a dream. They dreamed of a Messiah. They dreamed of just rulers. They dreamed of a new day for all people. The Magi had a dream, and this dream led them to action. They journeyed to unknown places. They followed a star. They walked for days to get to Jesus. So may we be like the Magi. May our dreams inspire action. May we worship the one true God. Amen. Now please join us in the opening hymn.
Join me in our prayer of confession. God, I love to worship you when the stars are bright above me. I love to worship you when the sky is clear and the breeze just right. I love to worship you when the journey to Bethlehem is an easy one. Unfortunately, as you know, this journey of life, love, and faith is rarely easy. Now and again, the stars disappear. My feet get blisters, and the journey is far too long and lonely. On these days, forgive me for giving up quickly. Forgive me for allowing the dream to die and for taking the shortcut home. I want to be as brave as the Magi. I want to persevere. Guide my feet. Show me the stars. Amen.
Receive now these words of assurance. Friends, hear this good news. The love of God is beyond measure, and you are included in that love. Know that you are forgiven and thus freed to love and serve. Alleluia. Amen. Now, as we pass the peace of Christ, please use the chat window on the live stream page to share your greetings.
Oh, Hello and welcome to Children's Moments. The scripture for today is John 1, 1 through 18, and the word of the day is Word. If you're following along with the worksheet, the leaflet we are using is titled Jesus, the Word. First off, Happy New Year! It may be a few days into the new year, and we are near the end of the Christmas season where the Magi journey to deliver the presents to baby Jesus. The scripture is a lengthy one and a bit repetitive, so I'll do my best to fill you in on the details. You know, at the beginning of movies, let's take Disney's Moana, where a lot of details are happening all at once and you are trying to still figure out who the movie or story is about. That is basically what is happening in the beginning of the book of John. John tells of this Word who was with us from the very beginning, just like baby Moana at the beginning of her movie. Though John just doesn't tell us that this Word has been with us since the beginning, he tells us that this Word was with God and was God. And this Word was made good and becomes the light and life of all people. We come to find that this Word John is talking about is none other than Jesus himself. Wait, what? Hold on. Jesus was the Word? You might be thinking, but Jesus was born in a manger. How can Jesus be God or God be Jesus? I know this might be confusing, but it also is absolutely wonderful. As you continue thinking on this, I encourage you to talk with your family members on God becoming human, or God becoming just like you or me or you, me and you? Anywho, this is only the beginning of Jesus' story, and trust me, it gets wilder and wilder. So buckle up and get ready to learn more about Jesus in our future children's moments. Amen.
Giving. Good morning. I'm Craig Roberts, your worship leader, and I don't think I've ever meant it more than when I say today, Happy New Year. Our scripture reading today is Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in the dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road.
What will you receive? I know it sounds like kind of an inappropriate question, given that it's right after Christmas. Even in this COVID-ravaged year, most of us can probably say that we know that we have received much. Just in the most literal of terms, we've likely been a part of giving and receiving Christmas gifts over these past few weeks. In lieu of some of our traditional gatherings, we have at least been able to drop off presents on front porches or add to the flood of mail and packages that have been shipped from here to there across the country. I've got baggies of Christmas cookies stashed away in my freezer, distributed by kind neighbors. I'm putting away gifts I received from family. No, even in this very untraditional year of Christmas celebrations, I can say that I didn't go without. I received plenty. And it feels as if it's time to clean up. Put it all away. Christmas is coming to an end. The time for receiving is officially over. Besides, didn't someone older and wiser than us always say that it's better to give than to receive? It's a refrain we hear often around the holidays or any time of year, really. I think it's even in the Bible, right? And we know that there's a great deal of truth in that statement. There are even scientific studies about the health benefits of generosity. Based on our own experience, we can attest to the fact that giving often feels as good as, if not better, than receiving. And as we read the scriptural account of what's called Epiphany, the story of the Magi's visit to the Christ child, the giving is a critical part of it. It's one of our favorite parts of the story. The beautiful treasure, the gold, the frankincense, the myrrh, not the most traditional baby gifts, but often said to symbolize different aspects of Jesus's nature, given in order to honor and praise the Messiah. But what about the receiving? What, if any, significance does receiving have in this passage? There's a desert monk of the early church named Abba Pohlmann who once said, "It is more hospitable to receive than to give. It is more hospitable to receive than to give." Could that possibly be true? Could it have any relevance in terms of our scripture reading for today? I want to back up for a minute and say that the word epiphany comes from a Greek word that means appearance. So the church celebrates Epiphany Sunday on the Sunday that falls nearest to the end of the Christmas season, a season that lasts for 12 days. And it's the time when we celebrate God's appearance or revelation to the world in Christ. We sometimes use the word epiphany in a personal way to describe our own personal aha moments. Epiphany in our religious context is a large-scale aha moment, a communal aha moment of seeing the divine revealed in a human person, the Christ child. And on this day of Epiphany in the church, we always focus on this visit of the Magi to the manger. This day is sometimes called Three Kings Day, but the truth is we don't know how many were in that entourage. We tend to think of three kings because of the three gifts that are named, but in reality, they are a somewhat unknown and mysterious bunch. We don't know their names or numbers or exactly where they came from. We do know that they were Gentiles and possibly magicians and most certainly astrologers. They were outsiders, certainly considered exotic in the countryside hills and the streets of Bethlehem. They were guided, we know, by a star, which in their tradition was believed to be the angel or counterpart of a great person. And they came offering gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But if we dig an inch deeper, we realize that the gifts given by the Magi were given in response to something. They were given in response to something they had received or that they perceived they were receiving. They were given in response to this holy epiphany, this guiding star, this mysterious revelation of God in the child. In Christmas stories and pageants, we see a relatively neat, if not entirely orderly, depiction of this event as the Magi follow the star proceeding toward the child, bearing their gifts, usually to the tune of We Three Kings. Sometimes a king stops to wave to a parent or a grandparent, but for the most part, they march up to the appointed spot to drop off their treasures. But the wanderer in me has to wonder if it was really all that orderly and if it was really all that clear to the Magi what they would ultimately find, what they would ultimately receive beneath that star. Poet T.S. Eliot also wondered about this in his poem called Journey of the Magi. Speaking in the voice of one of the travelers, the poem begins like this. A cold coming we had of it, just the worst time of year for a journey, and such a long journey. The ways deep and the weather sharp, the very dead of winter. And the camels galled, sore-footed, refractory, lying down in the melting snow. There were times we regretted the summer palaces on slopes, the terraces, and the silken girls bringing sherbet. Then the camelmen cursing and grumbling and running away, and the night fires going out, and the lack of shelters, and the cities hostile, and the towns unfriendly, and the villages dirty and charging high prices. A hard time we had of it. At the end, we preferred to travel all night, sleeping in snatches, with the voices singing in our ears, saying that this was all folly. And whether that actual journey was like Eliot imagined it or not, I do think it was likely the Magi weren't certain about where they were going, why they were following this star, what they would find there, receive when they finally arrived. And I imagine it did at times seem like perhaps it was all folly, following the star, bearing the gifts to this yet unknown child of promise. And yet they were driven, They moved on. They were compelled. They followed the star, the light, and even if they didn't know exactly what they were to receive, they sensed it was worth the journey. And I wonder, too, in our modern day celebrations of this season of Christmas, if we know for certain what we've received. Of course, we know what we've received. My brother-in-law put together my new coat rack. I've taken the tags off my sweater. I'm reading the directions for my new knife sharpener. But do we leave the Christmas season knowing what we've received from God? In the gift of God's revelation to the world, are we able to grasp what we've truly received? Like the Magi were drawn toward the light, the Christmas season inclines our spirits toward the holy. We sense the meaning and importance of the journey, but do we fully know what we've received? My most honest response to that question for myself is that I'm not sure it's even entirely possible, because we're still on the journey. We're on the path where sometimes we confidently move forward, trusting in the light that guides us, and where sometimes we might be overcome by the notion that it might all be folly. Faith doesn't offer us certainty. If we had certainty, we wouldn't need faith. But this passage reminds us to lean into the mystery, to trust the light that draws us forward, to trust the revelation that is still being revealed, knowing that we will unpack this gift from God, not in a single day, but perhaps over the course of our lifetimes. And I would be remiss if I didn't say that the beauty of this revelation on Epiphany Sunday is that it tells us in no uncertain terms that this gift that is still being revealed is a gift for everyone. This scene, when you think about it, is so outrageous. To think of these foreign Gentile astrologers traveling in caravan to pay homage to the King of the Jews. This Magi crew would have been about as suspect to those communities in which they traveled as any. So all debate about who's in and who's out, who's worthy and who's unworthy, who's included and who's not included, is irrelevant, because the divine message right from the get-go was that this child, this revelation, was and is for everyone. And we can be assured, reassured, that the gift is for each one of us, no matter who we are or where we've been or what has happened, is happening, or will happen in our lives. The gift is for each one of us. There is nobody beyond the bounds of worthiness if only we allow ourselves to receive it. We gather around the communion table this morning. We do it virtually, but we do it in order to share in God's abundant gifts. What gift does God hope you will receive this year? Is it grace? Is it love? Is it courage? Is it joy? Is it compassion for yourself, for others, the capacity to forgive, wisdom and guidance for the uncertain places of this life's journey, healing of old wounds? Is it hope? The one who created you, the one who loves you, the one who cherishes you, extends to you the gift that you need this year. The season of Christmas is nearing the time of being over. But the journey of our hearts has just begun anew. The star shines above us. God's grace is alive and present with us. Christ is here. God's hand is extended. What will you receive? Join our hearts and spirits as we go to God in this time of prayer. Will you pray with me? Loving and gracious God, we thank you for holy seasons that remind us of who you are and how you move and work in our lives. We thank you for the gentleness and hope of Christmas and for gifts that you offer us with such extravagance and love. Help us to see and know and treasure these gifts, even when veiled in mystery, and help us to unwrap them over the course of our lifetimes. Transform us by what we have received, are receiving from you, that we might be transformative agents in this world, a world still hungry for the gifts of love, of grace, of hope, of life that you give. At the turning of this year, we are mindful of all that has been difficult about this past year. We pray for those who have suffered great losses in the midst of this pandemic, for those who have lost a sense of security, for those who have lost jobs, for those who have lost hope, for those who have lost homes, for those who have lost dear loved ones. We lift up the family and friends of Alan, as well as others who are grieving as this year turns. We acknowledge that there have been brighter spots in this past year, and we are grateful for all that has sustained us over these many months. As we turn into 2021, renew our hope and joy. Give us patience and a strong commitment to love and support one another, as well as all of those who are most vulnerable, as we seek to move toward a place of recovery and wellness. Turn our hearts and spirits to you when we are distracted or overcome. Help us to lean toward your light, knowing and trusting that you guide us in and through all things. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we remain in a spirit of prayer and remembering all of the ways that your church is still supporting the community with the Wednesday evening to-go meals, the medical clinic, and the monthly meal at the homeless teen shelter in Hillcrest, we give of our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
the prayer of dedication. God of light and promise, we bring our gifts to further your work in our world. May they bring your light to those overwhelmed by shadows, pain, and the loneliness. Accept these gifts of money and time, indeed, the gifts of our very selves. Let them shine for all to see and be brought into the sphere of your love and righteousness. Amen.
We join now for this time of communion, knowing that we can't gather literally around this table, but that we gather in spirits, that our hearts draw together, knowing that Christ is among us and binds us together in this place of abundance and of grace. I invite you to have your communion elements ready in front of you and to participate and follow along in the liturgy on your screens. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered in this community and on the gifts of bread and fruit of the vine that are before us. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. We share in the body of Christ, in the breaking of this bread. We share in the cup of blessing, in the sharing of this cup. I invite you now to receive your elements, the body of Christ, the blood of Christ, given for you.
Fountain, pour and fountain, following God.
let us go forth into this week, into this brand new year, following light, following love, following grace. Let us lean into mystery and be about discovering all that we have received, all that the world has received. Go with the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit that binds us together now and forevermore. Amen.